Welcome back. This week, our goal is to review the imperative paradigm. We're going to be using the programming language C. As a background, it's important to remember that the imperative paradigm is all about fully specified data and instructions. Also, that the imperative paradigm is focused on how rather than what. So how we do something instead of what we are doing. And the meaning of that is that we're going to be working with variable functions and control structures, loops, and conditions. The good news is that most of these things are similar in Java, C++, and C. Therefore, because you know Java, you already know them. Conditional statements and loop statements are the same in Java, C++, and C. Functions are really similar. We're gonna review small differences. However, variables, and in general, data handling is gonna have important differences, and we are gonna use most of our time this week reviewing that. Particularly, we need to review arrays and something called structs and pointers. Obviously, there are no classes in C. C is an imperative language. Classes are going to appear in C++. And Java is going to take that concept from there. However, you will notice that the compilers that we're going to use work with C and also with C++, because several concepts apply to C and C++. Sometimes you are going to read C/C++ as one way to identify that we are talking about both languages. So in the rest of this video, I'm going to review what do you need to get started with C. Then in another video, I'm going to talk about primitive data types, arrays, and strings. Then we're going to review pointers. Then typedef, enum, and struct. And we're going to end this week reviewing function calls and parameters in C. Let's start. You need to install a compiler for C. My recommendation is that you can install Microsoft Visual Studio. That environment is gonna be useful for both C and later, the next week, for C++. There is a document with instructions about how to get and install Microsoft Visual Studio, so I recommend you to go to Blackboard and follow the instructions to have this environment in your computers. As a plan B, I am sharing with you first an online compiler for C++. The link is on the screen. You can go to this webpage and using your browser, you can write a program in C and you can compile and run the program on the browser. I do not recommend this one to do big programs like your project for this week. However, it's useful if you want to test small programs, a few lines of code. Some of the examples that I'm going to be showing you during the videos are going to be done in this online compiler. And finally, another option, Deep C++ is an old development environment. However, it's small and it could be useful if you have issues installing Microsoft Visual Studio or if you do not have enough space or something. So again, the online compiler and Deep C++ are plan B. My advice, install Visual Studio. You're going to be using it this week with C, next week with C++, and later, one more week, that we're going to be practicing both C and C++ together before the midterm. I'm going to provide an introduction to the topics mentioned before. However, you need to read the textbook in order to fully understand and practice each of them. Additional reference that you can use instead of the textbook or with the textbook are the following. Number one, the best resource to learn C is the book from Kernighan and Ritchie. Dennis Ritchie is the author of The Language C. So this is a good book to read. I am showing in the slide a link where you can find the first edition of the book so you can take a look. Additionally, I am sharing with you this tutorial. It's a PDF file and cover most of the topics that we are going to be reviewing this week. Programs in C are collections of functions. Functions are what we call it methods in Java. Some functions are defined by the programmer, and there are functions in libraries. So you can use libraries in your program. Also, we can use variables, and there are local variables inside of functions and global variables. Global variables are variables that we declare outside of any function. Finally, like in Java, it's mandatory to have a function with the name main, and that is the entry point for the program. This is a program in C. First, notice the comments. The comments are the same as in Java. You can have multiple line comments or single line comments. Second, the sharp include, that is equivalent to the keyword import in Java, that help you to include libraries. In C, the name of the library go inside of the angular brackets, and all the libraries are files.h. So in this example, stdio.h and math.h are libraries. As you can see, the keyword class is not here, so no classes. The full program, the file, have two methods, my function and main, and there is one global variable foo. Instead of methods, we call main and my function functions. So methods when they are inside of classes, like in Java or in C++, but when you do not have classes, you call them function. Most of the lexical, syntactical, and semantical rules from Java apply to C and C++. An important characteristic of main in C is the fact that main can be of type void or int. If you remember, in Java, main is void. However, in C and in C++, this can be void or int. Moreover, you can just write main without a type at the beginning, and by default is going to be int. If you do not put a type to a method in C, by default, that means that you want the method to return an integer value. Moreover, regarding the parameters of main, you can have main without parameters, or you can have main with two parameters, one integer and the other an array of characters. We're going to review arrays later. So main without parameters or main with two parameters, both options are correct. Therefore, you can have several different ways to represent main, as you can see here, and all of those represent the entry point of your program. This is quite different from Java, because in Java, main have one and only one signature. Here you have different signatures. To print something on the screen, we use the function printf. That function is in the library stdio.h, and it has two options. Number one, you can print a string using the string as a parameter, like here with hello world. But if you want to print a variable, or you want to print the result of calling a method, like here, you need two parameters for print. The first is a string with any text that you want to print, and with control symbol. The control symbols tell the compiler what are you going to print. Control symbols start with the percentage symbol and then a letter. The letter D represents integers, F floating point numbers, C characters, and S strings. And basically that are the types of the variables that you're gonna put as a second parameter. For instance, here you want to print the string result, and in that position you want to print a floating point number. After the string, after the comma, whatever you put here, function, variable, or whatever, that value is going to be printed in the position of the control symbol. So when you want to print strings and variables together, usually in Java, what you did was to concatenate everything. So you use the plus symbol to add strings and variables, like here. Now, in C, what you need to do is to put together the string and the control symbol, and later put the names of the variables separated by commas, like here. Regarding the input, to read something from the keyboard, we use the function scanf. This function has two parameters. The first one is a control symbol that represents the type of the value that we want to read. For instance, percentage D to read an integer number from the keyboard. And the second parameter, and this is something new, is the address of the variable in which we want to store that value. This is a key idea in C. Here in this line, we want to store the value that we read from the keyboard in the variable I. But instead of passing as a parameter I, we pass as a parameter the address of I. The ampersand is an operator in C, and that operator returns the address of the variable that we put in the right side. So ampersand I get the address of the variable I, and in that address, the function scan is going to store the number that the function read from the keyboard. In this example, when the user type 4, the number 4 is going to be stored in the variable I. Later, if you print I, you're going to have 4 printed on the screen. Notice that scanf needs the address of the variable, but printf uses as a parameter the name of the variable, not the address. Usually, when you use scanf, the second parameter is going to be ampersand something. Finally, regarding the control statements, conditional statements and loop statements, the ones that you know from Java, they work in the same way in C. So you can use for, while, do while, if else, and switch as usual. The main difference that you need to be aware of is that there are not Boolean values in C. The key idea in C is that 0 represents false and any other number is considered a true value. Therefore, in this example, here, if 2 plus 2, because that number is not 0, that condition is considered true. Therefore, that program will print hello. And the same thing works for the condition in the loop. With this key idea, you can start programming with C. My advice is go open the compiler and go ahead and write your first program. Start with a program with one function, main, then create more. Try with the control statement, create variables, play with print and scan. And when you're ready, move on to the next video.